بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. Students, welcome to virtual session of week 6 of IT project management course. So if you can listen to me properly, please raise your hands. Thank you. So we were talking about project time management, and I'm then going to continue from the slide from where I left. Can you see the slide? Okay, so we were talking about project time management. I'm going to give you a quick overview of the slides we covered, and then I'll continue from the slides. So these are the learning objectives I'm going to skip. I told you that delivering projects on time is one of the biggest challenges, because this is one of the requirements for the success of project. That is, the project should be on time as per scope and within budget. So the time constraint is very important. And I told you that because when you are managing time, you are asking people to follow the schedule, and the schedule issues are very common. And for this, I told you Myers-Briggs type indicators, which focuses on people's attitude towards structure and deadline, and the people behavior towards schedules and deadlines. And we asked you to explore Jail versus Peas and these four types of indicators of Myers-Briggs. And different cultures and even entire countries have different attitudes about schedules. Then these are the processes of project time management knowledge area: defining activities, then sequencing activities, estimating activity resources, estimating activity duration, then development of schedule, and then controlling the schedule. What is activity? Activity is an element of work which is found in the WBS at the lowest level. So the lowest level of WBS contains all the activities, and an activity is something which has an expected duration, cost, and resource. And when you define activity, it means you are developing a more detailed WBS, and you are adding some supporting explanation about the cost and duration. And when you make a list of activities, so you mention activity name, its ID, and the brief description of activity. The activity attributes include predecessor, it means the activity coming before it, successor, the activity coming after it, logical relationship, if there is any, among the activities, leads and lags, we are going to talk about in a short while, resource requirements for that activity, constraints, imposed dates for start and completion, and assumptions related to that activity. So we note down the activity name, ID, its description, and the attributes. Now, milestone, before going on, we need to know about milestone, which is a significant event that normally has near duration. So like when you set a milestone, like after 2 weeks, you are saying that you are going to deliver something, and it means the completion of it, completion of some task, and it has no milestone. It often takes several activities and a lot of work to complete a milestone, and there are useful tools for setting schedule goals and monitoring progress. So it means in your project, when you are developing the schedule, you can have several milestones, and then you can perform management of your project according to that. Examples include obtaining customer sign-off on key documents and completion of specific products. So the specific product is completed, you have finished the documentation, or you have got the signatures of customer on some deliverable. So it is a milestone. Sequencing of activities is important. So this step or this process involves reviewing activities and determining dependencies. Dependency or relationship is the sequencing of project activities or tasks, and you must determine dependencies in order to use critical path analysis. So for critical path analysis, to identify the critical path in your project, the path which is the longest path in the diagram which you are going to develop, and that the longest path and any activity on that path cannot be delayed. If it is delayed, it will delay the overall project, or increase the overall duration of project. So the dependency analysis is very important. So three types of dependencies exist among activities: Mandatory dependencies, discretionary dependencies, and external dependencies. Mandatories are the ones which are inherent in the nature of the work being performed in the project and sometimes refer to as hard logic. Like these types of dependencies cannot be avoided. For example, you need a module as input in some other module, so and you are performing calling those modules different activities. So the second module cannot start before the first finish. This type of dependency is mandatory dependency. The second type is discretionary dependencies defined by the project team, sometimes referred to as soft logic. It means these are soft logic and it can be changed by giving more attention and should be used with care since they may limit the later scheduling options. So you must keep in mind the hard logic and mandatory dependencies while developing the schedule, but should minimize the number of discretionary dependencies in the schedule because it will make you in a difficult state when there will be schedule in the later state of your project when the schedule will have to be adjusted according to the requirements of customers. The external dependencies involve relationship between project and non-project activities. So let's go further. Network diagrams are used to sequence activities or to show the sequencing of activities. It is a schematic display of the logical relationship among or sequencing of project activities. And we use two types of formats in networking while developing network diagram. And we can use any when you are making this diagram. So network diagram can be made, so you can follow any of these formats. The first format is called activity on arrow diagram, AOA network diagram. So this appears like this. This diagram is made, like here you can see that A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, I, J, these all are activities. And there's a number it is written with it, with like A equal to 1 means A activity has 1 day duration. D activity requires 4 days of work. F activity requires 4 days of work. Similarly, I activity requires 2 days of work. So the number written beside this shows the duration of this activity. And now this nodes, you can see here that these nodes are actually signifying the sequence. Like at node 1, activity A, B, and C will be started. Activity A finishes after 1 day. Activity B finishes after 2 days and goes to 3. Activity C finishes after 3 days and goes to 4. Once activity A has finished, activity D can be started, which is depending on activity A. So D cannot be started once A has not finished. And once B is over, it goes to 5. And before starting H activity, activity D and E should be finished. So it means H activity is dependent on D and E. And E is dependent on B. And this activity J is dependent on I, H, F, and all of the previous activities to be completed. Once they are all completed, then you can start the G activity. So this diagram is actually showing you the dependence. This is also called activity on arrow diagramming method, and activities are represented by arrows. Nodes or specifiers are the starting and ending points of the activities. But this diagram can only show finish to start dependency. Like, for example, E cannot start once B has finished. He can only start once B has finished. Or G can only start once C has finished. So C need to be finished for G to be started. So this means it is finished to start dependency, which it is showing. Like C should be finished so that G can start. So this one type. Now you will see onward that there are different types of other dependencies as well. But this diagramming method can only show finished to start dependencies. So is it clear? Is it clear? Okay. Any questions so far? Okay. Okay, let's move onwards. Now, how you create this activity on arrow diagram? First of all, we find all the activities that start at node 1. like at the beginning of project, which activities can be started. So draw their finish notes and draw arrows between node 1 and those finish notes and put the activity letter or name of the duration estimate on the associated arrow. Now you know when we made the, I'm going backward, now you see here, when I was identifying the activity attributes, I identified the predecessor, successor, imposed dates, the duration, constraints, and everything in this list. So when I'm going to make this diagram, this type of diagram, I know the duration of all the activities. So I put the activity letter or name and duration estimate on the associated arrow. Continue drawing the actual diagram, working from left to right. Look for bursts and merges. Like bursts and merges means bursts occur when a single node is followed by two or more activities. For example, in this diagram, there is a burst at 3 and 1. So, like after one, 3 activities will be started. After 3, ENF will be started. Okay, so this is burst. And merge occurs when two or more nodes precede a single node. Like, can you tell me where is merge in this diagram? At which node there is merge in this diagram? No, not two. I said two or more activities merge in a node. Yes, 5 and 6, both are true answers because two activities are merging at 5 and then one activity is going out, that is H. And in case of 6, H, F and I are getting an input in this node 6 and then J activity will be started. So there is a burst at 1 node and 3 node and there is a merge at node 5 and node 6. Continue drawing the project network diagram until all the activities are included on the diagram that have dependencies. As a rule of thumb, all arrowheads should face towards the right and no arrows should cross on an AO network diagram. So if you are given a table of activities and their duration and you are asked to make the diagram, you have to start from left, you have to start making diagram from left to right and you have to be careful that there should be no line crossing in your diagram. Yes, sure, I can repeat. I am saying that whenever you have to draw the activity on arrow diagram, you know that activities are represented by arrows and nodes are the starting and ending point of activities. So first of all, in the diagram, like in this diagram, you make a node 1 and then see that which activities can be started at this point. So any activity which is not dependent on any other activity can be started. So at point 1, we started A, B, and C because they were not dependent on anything. So we started this activity, and then we saw that which activity is dependent on A. So what we do is that we make a note 2, which is signifying the end of activity A, and we will see that which activity is dependent on A. So once A has finished, so that activity can be started. So that's why D activity was dependent on A, so we after 2, we have mentioned D activity. And then the B activity, like two activities were depending on B, E and F. So once B has finished, so E and F can be started. So we start making a diagram from node 1 and then So, as a rule of thumb, all arrowheads should face towards the right and no arrows should cross on an AO network diagram. So, although it's a rule of thumb, the 5 and 6, I told you that when you are making the diagram, burst occurs when a single node is followed by two or more activities. It means two or more activities are going out from a node. It is called burst. So in this diagram, where two or more activities are going out? On 1, and on 3. In 1, 3 activities are going out, in 3, 2 activities are going out. So this is called burst. Is it clear? Monika, is it clear? Okay, so this was burst. Second thing was, this is just a name, we give it like burst. Like burst is a name which is given to them that whenever there will be two or more activities going out from a node, it is called burst. And a merge is when two or more nodes proceed a single node, like two or more activities are like two or more activities are merging up in a single node. For example, in node 6, 3 activities are merging. In node 5, 2 activities are merging. So when two of arrows are coming in a single node, two or more arrows, it is called merge. So there is merge at 5 and 6. Okay, is it clear? Okay. Okay, now the second type of diagram is precedence diagramming method. Diagramming of precedence network diagram. In this diagram, activities are represented by boxes and arrows shows relationship between activities. How you place the arrows represent the relationship. And it is more popular than the method used by project management software. More popular than arrow diagramming method. This is precedence diagramming method, and the previous was also called AOA, activity and arrow method, or it is also called ADM, arrow diagramming method. And it is used by this method, precedence diagram, as used by the project management softwares. And it is better to show different types of dependencies. In the AOA diagram, we were only able to show the finish to start dependencies, and here you can many. Now, this figure shows that how many types of dependencies are there. So, the previous diagram was only able to show the finish to start dependencies, only the first one, and now precedence diagram can show the four types of dependencies, start to start, finish to finish, and start to finish as well. Now let's see how this works, or what does it mean. Finish to start means task B cannot start until task A finishes, and this is shown in this way. The arrow, the placement of boxes which are representing activities, and the placement of the arrow, like if you say that this activity is this arrow is showing that A should finish so that B can start. The second dependency is start to start, and this is represented by such kind of arrow. As you can see here, the arrow is going out from the left side to B, getting input. So it means task B cannot start until task A starts. So task B is also dependent on task A, but task B cannot start till A starts. The third one is finish to finish, and this is the same type of arrow but going from the right side. Task B cannot finish until task A finishes. And the last one is start to finish. That means task B cannot finish until task A starts. So this is shown by such kind of arrow that A cannot start until, or task B cannot finish until task A starts. And this was showing task B cannot start until task A finishes. And this is showing task B cannot finish until task A starts. So this one, start to finish and finish to start, are the opposite ones. So are these clear? Okay, this is very important to understand these types of dependencies. Now this is how the PDM diagram looks like. The boxes are showing activities. You can see here that activity A, B, C, D, all activities are placed over here. And in the previous diagram we said that activity A, B and C can start once the project is started. So we can start this activity. So in every box we are mentioning the activity name, its start date, its finish date, its ID, its duration, and the resources it is using, or we can specify more attributes as well. So you can specify as many as you want. So you specify it in this way, and you can see here that the arrows are showing actually finish to start dependencies, that although it's showing only these types of dependencies, but the more dependencies can be shown. So it means task B cannot start until A task A finishes, task H cannot start until task D and E finishes, So we have made the same diagram which was made on activity on arrow, and now it is precedence diagramming method. So is it clear? Any question from this diagram? Okay. So now we have made a diagram. We have made now in the diagram is fully mapping the different types of dependencies. Now we have to talk about estimation of activity resources, that how much resources an activity will be using. I told you previously that we make work breakdown structure, and now we have resources, so we have to make a resource breakdown structure as well. Before estimating activity duration, you must have a good idea of the quantity and the type of resources that will be assigned to each activity. And what are resources? Resources are the number of people, the amount of equipment and materials. So you know that if we deploy more resources, we can sometimes reduce the duration of activity. And sometimes by decreasing the resources, the duration of activity gets increased. So we have to make appropriate estimate, and we want to make our estimate as much correct as possible so that our plan remain consistent in future as well. So first of all, you should, because you have to make PDM diagram, and this is certainly based on the duration of estimate, so the duration should be correct. So for that, what we are doing is that we consider some important issues in estimating resources. How difficult will it be to do specific activities on this project, and what is the organizational history in doing similar activities? Are the required resources available? These are some questions which we ask before starting. A resource breakdown structure is a hierarchical structure that identifies the project resources by category and type. So we make this type of structure. Now, to make activity duration estimates, we first need to be familiar about the terms of duration and effort. Duration includes the actual amount of time worked on an activity plus elapsed time. Effort is the number of work days or work hours required to complete the task. So duration requires the actual amount of time you spent on that plus elapsed time, some extra time which you spent. And effort means the actual time spent on that. Effort does not normally equal duration. Duration is always greater than effort. So effort is less, like we are excluding the time, some elapsed time from the duration, and we get the effort time. People doing the work should help create estimates, and experts should review them. So the people who will actually be working according to that plan should help the project manager to make the estimates. So if the team is involved, then in making estimates, then the estimates will be realistic. Three-point estimate is one of the methods used when you are making the estimates about activity duration. So instead of providing an activity estimate as a discrete number, such as 4 weeks, it's often helpful to create a three-point estimate. So we do not make estimates randomly. We follow three-point method. So what three-point estimate tells is that this estimate includes an optimistic, most likely, and pessimistic estimate, such as optimistic means you are trying to be very optimistic that this activity will be completed in this much days. Most likely, which you think that this much time this activity will take normally, and in worst case, the estimate will activity will take this much time, that is called pessimistic estimate. For example, if you are making an estimate for an activity, you say it will take 3 weeks, it is optimistic. If you are saying it will take 4 weeks for the most likely, and 5 weeks for the pessimistic estimate. So it's going to, like you are saying, that it's going to take so much time. I mean, it's going to take 5 weeks time. Another person is saying that it's going to be 3 weeks time. So the two estimates are totally different. But since this is three-point estimate method, so you are asking every person to give the pessimistic, optimistic, and most likely estimate. Three-point estimates are needed for PERT and Monte Carlo simulations. So now we'll see that what these PERT and Monte Carlo simulations are in a short while. and I hope this is included, the slides are included for this. First part provides a formula. I think it's included in the book, but not over here. PERT technique and Monte Carlo simulation provides a formula where you place the optimistic, most likely, and pessimistic estimates value and give you the duration of the activity. I would recommend that you read more details about PERT and Monte Carlo simulation from the textbook. Pessimistic means like your maximum time. The optimistic means the minimum time activity will take. Most likely means the average time, on average how much time it takes. And pessimistic means in the worst case, the worst case scenario in this activity will take. The maximum time which you think this activity can make if everything goes wrong. Okay, Amar, is it clear? Okay, good. Now, when you have estimates, you use the results of the time management process to determine the start and end date of the project. Ultimate goal is to create a realistic project schedule that provides a basis for monitoring the progress. And we use Gantt charts, critical path analysis, critical chain scheduling, and PERT analysis to develop the schedule and to make correct estimates. Now, what Gantt chart is, it provides a standard format for displaying project schedule information by listing project activities and their corresponding start and finish date in the calendar format. So in the Gantt chart, different symbols are used. The black diamond shows milestones, the thick black bar shows summary tasks, lighter horizontal bar shows the duration of tasks, and arrow shows the dependency between tasks. Now if you see this Gantt chart diagram, you will see here that the tasks or the activities are mentioned over here in this column. The schedule or calendar is appearing over here, May 29, June 5, June 12, June 19. Okay. And now these horizontal bars are actually showing the activities. This is activity A, activity B, activity C. All the activities are being shown over here. So the activity box or the rectangle is starting when the activity is going to start. For example, here you can see that the activity A is going to start on Wednesday or May 29. And then this activity D is going to start on May 30 because the first activity has 1 day duration, so it has finished to start dependency, and on Wednesday activity A started, on Thursday activity D can start. So you can see that the arrows are showing that types of dependencies, and this is the type of Gantt chart, and you make the duration of an estimate, you can develop this Gantt chart for using the Microsoft Project software or any other, some other software also provide the facility to make Gantt chart tools are available to make Gantt chart. This is another sample Gantt chart, and here you can see that you have, like, I want to maximize this diagram for you. Now you can see here that this thick horizontal bar is showing the summary task. This diamond shaped symbol, I hope it's clear, this diamond shaped symbol is showing the milestone. And these arrows are showing the dependencies. And this is the individual task bar, which is showing the actual duration of this activity. And all these are the activities mentioned over here. Many people like to focus on meeting milestones, especially for large projects. And milestone emphasize important events and accomplishment on projects. And I told you that milestone has no duration. And create milestone by entering a task with a zero duration, and you can mark any task as a milestone. Now you see here in this diagram that there are many milestones mentioned. One of the milestones is mentioned on 4th January, then it's on I think 10th of January, and there are many milestones mentioned over here. So these milestones help you out to work according to plan in a more realistic way. So these are milestones that are in the Gantt chart. So when you define your milestones and you identify your milestones, you should follow the SMART criteria. That milestone should be specific, like you should know that this is the milestone we are going to achieve, measurable, assignable, realistic, and time frame. And by picking the first word of every first letter of every word, we call it SMART criteria. That milestone should be specific, measurable, assignable, realistic, and time frame. The five key points of using project milestones include define milestones early in the project and include them in the Gantt chart. So don't try to define milestones in the later stages of the project. Keep milestones small and frequent. The set of milestones should be all encompassing. Each milestone must be binary, means it should be either complete or incomplete. And carefully monitor the critical path. This is sample tracking Gantt chart, which is showing the actual dates and the showing the slip milestone. Like the actual milestone was here on 5th of May, and it is this task is getting completed on 13th of May. So this hollow diamond is showing the slip milestone, and here as well it is showing the slip milestone. And these activities which are slightly ahead of the planned activities are showing that how many activities were lagging. So I think that this Gantt chart is better because here you can see, like when your project is moving on, you are in the middle of the project, you can see that which tasks were delayed, which milestones you have missed. Okay, so the actual and slipped dates as well. Now there is a method called critical path method, which is a network diagramming technique used to predict total project duration. So previously you said that you have mentioned the duration of all activities and you have made a precedence diagram as well. Now the CPF diagram the first purpose is to estimate the total project duration, and the second is to identify the critical path in the project. A critical path for a project is a series of activities that determine the earliest time by which the project can be completed. The critical path is the longest path through the network diagram and has the least amount of slack or float. So what slack or float is, both means the same, but what it is, we are going to talk in a short while. So we determine the earliest time of completion of project, and it is the longest path through the network. It means it includes all the activities which are combinedly making up the longest path and telling us the real duration of project. And if any of the activity on the critical path gets delayed, the overall duration of project will be increased. Overall project will delay. Now, the network, the critical path has the least amount of slack. And what slack or float is the amount of time an activity can be delayed without delaying the succeeding activity or project finish date. For example, you have finished your activity, but before starting the other activity, the next activity requires input from two activities. You have finished your work, but the other person is still working. So if the other person will complete the work, only then you can move to the next activity. So you are waiting for the other person. So it means you can delay your activity completion by that much time that other person is working on this activity. So I'll tell you with a diagram about it. To calculate that critical path, first develop a good network diagram, add the duration estimate for all activities. The longest path is the critical path. If one or more of the activities on the critical path takes longer than planned, the whole project schedule will slip unless the project manager takes corrective actions. Now if you see this diagram, there are multiple paths to reach from node 1 to 8. If you are moving from, it is going to take 14 days. It means 1 day plus 4 plus 6 plus 3. it takes 14 days. Part 2 is 2 plus 5 plus 6 plus 3, it takes 16 days. Part 3 is BFJ, it takes 9 days. Part 4 is CGIJ, which takes 14 days. And as we said, the critical path is the longest path for the network diagram. Part 2, which takes 16 days, is a critical path for this project. Sorry, Amal, I couldn't get what are you saying. I'm saying that from node 1 till the last node, you explore all possible paths. Like the possible paths to reach from node 1 to it. So you can go this way, 1, 2, 5, and 8. Or you can go 1, 3, 5, 6, 8. Or you can go 1, 3, 6, 8. The other path is 1, 4, 7, 8. You want to go to 8. And there are multiple ways by which you can go. Yes, because this lecture is included in your final exam. So you may be asked to, you may be given a diagram and may be asked to tell the longest path and or identify the critical path. Okay? So the longest path. So when you identify all possible paths, then you identify the longest path. And the longest path is the one which is called critical path. So in this diagram, path 2, which is BEHJ, which is taking up 16 days, is the longest path. No, you should be able to draw as well. Like you may be given activity duration and you may be asked to draw the network diagram as well. Like you are given like this, these are the activities A, B, C, D, E, F, G. So you may be given a list of activities and you may be given like a table like this. I think the table is here. You may be given this type of table where you are told the activity start date, finish date and dependency. Like if you explore your book, there will be a table. There will be a table which can be, you may be asked to draw the diagram as well. No, you have to see that, like if activity A, activity D is depending on A. So it means once A is finished, you can start activity D. So in the table, you are given activity name, its duration, and its dependency if it is depending on some other activity. So you will be given a table with three columns, activity name, activity duration, and activity dependency. So if activity D is dependent on A, so activity D can be started once A is finished. So in this way you make your diagram, and once your diagram gets made, then you can identify the longest path, that which is the longest path in which all you are adding up the duration. See, like you are activity A was 1 day, D was 4 days, so 1 plus 4 plus 6 plus 3, you called it 14 days. Okay? A project team at Apple Computer puts a stuffed gorilla on the top of the cubicle of a person currently managing critical path. Isn't it interesting? That in your project, since you don't want any activity on critical path to get delayed. For example, in this diagram, the critical path was B, E, H, and J. So it means the person working on activity B should not be disturbed so that the duration do not get increased. If the person working on activity B will be disturbed or interrupted, the duration of B will increase. So if it will increase, the overall duration of project will increase. Because for this project, the overall duration is 16 days. So if the B will increase, or if the duration of E will increase, or H will increase, or J will increase, so the overall duration, which is 16 days, will increase. Is it clear? So the duration of any activity which is on the critical path should not be increased, should not increase at any cost. So what they do in Apple computers is that because they work in a group where in a one room there are many people working on in a cubicles on different parts of the project. So what they do is they put a stuffed gorilla on the cabin of the person who is working on the critical path. So everybody becomes aware that they should not disturb that person having the gorilla. So if that person has done the task and now somebody else is working on the critical path, so they put the gorilla on the person working on the next activity, which is on the critical path. So now when they see the gorilla, they see that they don't have to disturb that person. Critical path is not the one with all the critical activities. It only counts for time. It is not the one which is having the critical activity. We are calling it critical because of time. Remember that the example of growing grass being on the critical path by Disney Animal Kingdom. So they were developing a Disney Animal Kingdom park, and they made a huge park, and activities were having different durations. But since growing of grass takes time, so the growing grass was the activity which took the longest time. But of course, growing grass was not a critical task. There can be more than one critical path if the length of two or more paths are the same, and critical paths can change as the project progresses. Of course, because when you are you made initial estimates and when you are moving on with the project, so you'll see that some of the projects require less time and some are actually required more time. So you have to keep an eye on the critical path and you have to revise it if it is getting changed during the project execution. So you can use critical paths to make schedule trade-offs. Free slack or free float is the amount of time an activity can be delayed. So there are some definitions. Without delaying the early start of an immediate following activity, which is called free slack. Total float is the amount of time an activity may be delayed from its early start without delaying the planned project finish date. So it means the total float we calculate it from the project finish date. A forward pass with an electric diagram determines the early start and early finish date, and the backward pass determines the late start and late finish date. I am skipping three slides about calculation of this free slack and total slack, and I'll explain it in our face-to-face class in the coming week. I'll dedicate some time from the other class for these few slides. This diagram needs explanation. I'm skipping these three slides, and I'll explain it in the face-to-face class. Using the critical path to shorten the project schedule, we can use it. Three main techniques for shortening the schedule. The first is shortening duration of critical activities by adding more resources and changing the scale. So since you know that the critical path is the longest path, and if any activity on the critical path gets delayed, the overall project will get delayed. But in the same way, if the activity on that path gets completed earlier, the overall duration of project will also decrease. So we can shorten the duration of critical activities by adding more resources or changing their scope. So you can put more emphasis on the activities to shorten the schedule. Crashing activities, you can use this method by obtaining the greatest amount of schedule compression for the least incremental cost. Like increasing some cost, you shrinken the schedule. Fast-tracking activities by doing them in parallel or overlapping them. So this is called fast tracking, that one the activity you are identifying the activities which can be overlapped. So once one activity is not finished or some part of it finished, you can start the next one. So you are performing overlapping or are doing the activities in parallel to receive the schedule. It is important to update project schedule information to meet time goals for a project, and critical path may change as you enter actual start and finish dates. And if you know that the project completion date will slip, you can negotiate with the project sponsor in advance. Instead of telling the sponsor at the end that the project date is slipping, So if you are a good project manager, you are using the critical path method to see the completion dates of every task, then you can predict in advance that the completion date is about to slip. Critical chain scheduling is a method of scheduling that considers limited resources when creating a project schedule and includes buffers to protect the project completion date. So in this way, in this method, what you do is that you try to minimize the schedule, try to keep you keep the worst case in mind when you're performing critical chain scheduling, and you can add buffers at the end of the completion date. Like, you do not tell your team the project completion dates, and you have kept buffer of time at the end. Or use theory of constraints, which is a management philosophy developed by the NFMM contract introduced in the book, and you can attempt to minimize multitasking, that when a resource works on more than one task at a time. So reduce multitasking. This figure shows the duration of projects without multitasking and with multitasking. Here in the above diagram, you will see that task 1 was completed after 10 days, then task 2 started, it was completed after 20 days. Although the duration it required was 10 days, but after 20 days, task 2 completed, and after 30 days, task 3 completed. If you perform multitasking, like instead of giving complete 10 days to task 1, you gave 5 days to task 1, 5 days to task 3, task 2, and 5 days to task 3. So in this way, task 1 completed after 20 days, task 2 completed after 25 days, and task 3 completed after 30 days. So in this as well, like the tasks are taking up the same time, so all three tasks are taking up the same time, but the completion dates of task 10, 1, 2 are ahead. Sorry for interruption, can you hear me now? Can you hear me? Okay. The second law is Parkinson's law, which says that the work expands to fill the time allowed. People never say that you have given us more time for work. For example, I give you a time for assignment, and I ask you to submit me an assignment after 2 months, and the assignment actually requires only 1 week. So you won't say this to me that the time is too much for assignment. Okay, you will remain quiet, but will never come to mean that the time given, you have given us too much time to do the assignment. What you will do is that you will do the assignment in 1 week, and then you will kill the rest of the time, or you will keep waiting till the last week, and then you will start. No, I'm not giving you assignment right now. I'm just giving you an example. Okay, I think you're very offended about listening about assignment. Don't worry. So, Parkinson's law states that work expands to fill the time allowed. So, if I ask you to do to work which requires 1 week, and I give you 1 month, so you will expand your work for 1 month. So this is Parkinson's law. In traditional estimates, people often add a buffer to each task and use it if it's needed. For example, if I ask you to tell how much time you require for this activity, I give you a task and then ask you how much time you need. So if you think that task requires 1 hour, you will say this to me that you need 3 hours. And why 3 hours? Not three, you still say it requires 2 hours. So what, and you know that actually this work will require 1 hour. Okay? So what you have done is that you have kept a buffer, or you have kept a cushion with you, that if you get delayed in doing this activity, you will have some extra time to do that. So people often add a buffer to each task and use it if it's needed or not. If it's not needed, they will not use it, but if it's needed, they can use their buffer. And critical chain scheduling removes those buffers from the available task and instead creates a project buffer or a feeding buffer. The project offer is the additional time added before the project due date. So instead of allowing everyone to keep an individual cushion or individual buffer, what you have done is that you have kept a larger size buffer before the end date of project, which is called project buffer. Like even if the project gets delayed, you will have some time with which you can compensate. Or feeding buffer, which is additional time which is added before task on a critical path. Like if a task on a critical path gets delayed, you will have a feeding buffer which you can add before that. And this diagram shows the critical chain. This is showing the critical chain, and this is showing the feeding buffer added before the critical task, and this is showing the project buffer which is added before the completion date of project. And X, the boxes containing X shows the task done by limited resources, and FB is showing the feeding buffer. And this is a critical chain, so because this required limited resources, the critical chain is this one. So you have added feeding buffers before the task, before the critical task, or the task having limited resources. PERT is a network analysis technique used to estimate project duration when there is a high degree of uncertainty about the individual activity. And it is a three-point estimate method, and this is the formula. Like for example, if a person tells you that this activity requires 8 days, and most likely it will require 10 days, and in the pessimistic time is 12 days, 24 days. So what you do is that you add optimistic time plus 4 times most likely time plus pessimistic time, and you are divided by 6. So when you add the values, 8 plus 4 multiplied by 10 plus 24, you get 12 days. So the 12 days, you will use 12 days on the network diagram when you are using PERT for activity duration estimates. Okay, I'm going to skip these slides, and which are quite obvious and for your reading. In the next week class, I'll explain you. I'll mark it in at the end. All of you who joined the sessions are marked present. So I'll explain these slides later. So any question from these? Okay, so if you have any question from these, or if you're unable to understand the last few slides, come to me or email me or ask me in the coming week class of databases. Okay? Thank you very much. So if you have next class, you can leave. No problem. Thank you very much.